Thank you to Antoinette Sayer from the IMF for her brilliant talk. Our next speaker has also had some truly unique experiences and achievements. He is immensely respected worldwide for having protected his people from repeated aggressions and is known as a true beacon of democracy. This is the revered political activist and 1996 Nobel Peace Prize laureate, José Ramos-Horta. In the early 70s, Ramos-Horta's Timor-Leste was under Portuguese rule and was waging a fierce fight for independence. In 1975, the popular movement of which Ramos-Horta was a key member announced independence. After only 9 days as foreign minister, a closer neighbour, Indonesia, annexed the oil-rich Timor-Leste. Ramos-Horta was forced into exile in Australia. With exceptional conviction, Ramos-Horta denounced the human rights violations inflicted on his people, earning him the prestigious Nobel Peace Prize. He reassumed his position of foreign minister in 2000 and served as president from 2007 to 2012. Despite numerous threats to his life, most notably when he survived a gunshot in 2008, José Ramos-Horta has pursued his campaign for peace and democracy, holding multiple roles in the United Nations. For the summit, he has produced a pre-recorded talk on the need for democratic leadership and global cooperation, particularly in solving the crises created by the coronavirus. There will be no Slido in Q&A for this event. Without further ado, it is our honour to welcome Nobel Peace Prize laureate and former president of Timor-Leste, José Ramos-Horta.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to participate in this Global Economic Summit with Warwick University. In these turbulent times, when uncertainty, suspicion, mistrust, fear, anger, and despair are palpable, I'm speaking to you from the tranquility of this village at the edge of the world. So I feel I should begin by sharing with you what is, albeit small, a large story of struggle, resilience, faith, and triumph. Timor-Leste emerged from centuries of colonization and occupation less than 20 years ago, when at the stroke of midnight on 20th May 2002, the flag of the UN Transitional Administration was lowered and our tricolor flag of red, black and yellow went up. This is a case study that illustrates how seemingly insurmountable challenges may be resolved when parties directly involved show real will to search for peace, and when in these circumstances the international community is united around the good offices of the UN Secretary General in support of the parties involved. After the hangover induced by the festivities, a new reality sets in, the harsh reality of building up a country and institutions from the ashes of war and to deliver the dividends of independence from ground zero, but steadily. Over the past 19 years, political leaders with different convictions and their agendas, civil society and the international community, join hands to address the multiple challenges confronting us and deliver to our people their very legitimate expectations, peace and the freedom dividends. First, we try to soften the extremely harsh social conditions we had inherited that deprive our people of a life living with dignity and safety. Anywhere we turned to then, there were extreme destitution and traumas, multiple pressing priorities demanding our attention and action. Understandably, there were tearful demands for justice for the crimes of the past. The wounds of the body and the soul were still burning. Upon deep reflection and with the weight of history and the weight of the future on our minds. As leaders, we resist the pressures to pursue justice through a special international ad hoc tribunal. We opted instead for healing the wounds of the body and soul, for reconciling our deeply traumatized communities, and simultaneously extend a hand of friendship and reconciliation with our giant neighbor, Indonesia. In response to demands for retributive justice, I would often respond, the denial of our people's right to self-determination and the violence inflicted on the people were grave injustices. But in the end, the will of the people, expressed through a popular consultation in 1999, was honored. So justice prevailed. If I am to cite salient examples of achievements in our journey since independence, I would name reconciliation and forgiveness as our greatest achievements. Inspired by our national hero, Mr. Xanana Guzmán, we walked halfway towards those who once called us enemy, and we embraced each other. We knew that only courage of the truly brave men and women to forgive and embrace the other side would spare us endless conflict and instability in the future. With Indonesia, we parted ways in the very traumatic months of August, September 1999. Indonesian leaders and society equally responded with an olive branch, with the same open heart and the statesmanship, and offered to assist the new country emerging from the ashes of the recent past. I dare to state, without hesitation, that there are no two countries in the entire Asia region that enjoy better relations between them than our two countries, the predominantly Catholic Timor-Leste and the predominantly Muslim Indonesia. Neighbors once locked in bitter conflict, today enjoy a vibrant relationship. Timor-Leste is 98% Catholic, with about 50,000 Protestants and a smaller Muslim community. All religions are treated equally. Diplomatic passports are issued for leaders of the three main religions. Financial assistance is allocated to each major religious group on a proportional basis. All Muslim holidays are observed. Simultaneously, as we addressed the issue of the heart and soul, we began to lay down the building blocks of the institutions of the state where none existed. This is a process that is continuing today. But how does one build institutions of state without a pool of highly educated and experienced people? In 2008, our government conceived and launched the Human Capital Development Fund with an average annual budget of $30 million towards providing scholarships in advanced studies in science, technology, economics, public administration, law and medicine in selected universities in Southeast Asia, Australia, Portugal, etc. 10 years ago, walking into a ministry or department, he would have seen dozens of highly paid foreign advisors doing line work. Today, wherever you go, you will see mostly young polyglot Timorese with advanced degrees and certificates obtained in the best academics and the professional institutes around the world. In 1975, the last year of Portuguese colonial rule, the average Timorese had a very short lifespan, living till 36 years of age. There were no Timorese doctors, not one. By 1978, this miserable life expectancy was further reduced to 33. By 1980, life expectancy improved slightly, and by 1999, it was 59 years. In 2002, at Independence, we had 19 medical doctors trained during the previous 24 years of Indonesian rule. Life expectancy at birth was about 59 years. Today, we have nearly 1,200 medical doctors, thanks to a unique program initiated in 2005, thanks to the extreme generosity of the governments of Cuba and, of course, Timor-Leste. Life expectancy stands today at 69.2 for men and 71 for women. In 2002, malaria was rampant and our major cause of debilitation and death. We are now malaria-free. Leprosy, this centuries-old fatal disfiguring bacteria that cast away fellow human beings to remote islands and valleys, has been eliminated in Timor-Leste. We enjoy fraternal relations with all regional and global powers, some of which are not friendly related to each other. God willing, by 2022, Timor-Leste will be ASEAN's 11th member. In 2018, in the framework of UNCLOS, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, assisted by some of the best international law minds, assigned by the UN Secretary General, we resolved our differences with Australia and agreed on a permanent maritime boundary. Our two countries enjoy a special relationship rooted in history and values of democracy and solidarity. Resolution of the maritime boundary dispute paves the way for the development of the Greater Sunrise gas field and other oil and gas potential in the Timor Sea. Esteemed ladies and gentlemen, sheltered in this tranquil, magic Far East land, without having to travel from our respective villages, towns and cities across the globe, we are able to communicate via different innovative communication tools. In the course of 2020, I have participated as keynote speaker and or as panelist in countless virtual conferences. From afar, we follow developments across the globe, in particular the COVID onslaught. And whenever I share information on the global pandemic with our communities across my country, our simple, humble people are confused how the mighty powers of the world are literally down on their knees. In March 2020, we closed borders, encouraged hand washing and mask use, and banned large events. In this deeply religious nation of 98% practicing Catholics, Sunday, Christmas, Easter masses always attract tens of thousands of faithful. So canceling such celebration was not a light decision. But our very independent-minded people promptly complied without protest. We are among the lucky few in the world without COVID-19 fatalities and so far without community transmission. But we couldn't have done it alone. The UN system, WHO, UNDP, UNICEF, World Food Program, and the countries like China, the US through its embassy in Timor-Leste, Japan, the European Union, Cuban and the Australian volunteer doctors, all working together, all assisted and worked closely with our own health officials and others in other branches of the state, quickly developed policies, put in place testing labs, quarantine facilities, and COVID treatment clinics. Much credit is due to WHO for initiatives it launched to ensure an equitable share of vaccines, to accelerate the development, production, and equitable access to COVID-19 tests, treatments, and the vaccines. WHO devised the so-called Access to COVID Tools, ACT, accelerator, made possible through global collaboration, bringing together governments, scientists, businesses, civil society, philanthropies, and global health organizations to ensure equitable distribution of these public goods, and especially to low-income and lower-middle-income countries. COVAX, the vaccines pillar of the ACT Accelerator, is co-led by WHO, Gavi, and the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, and support the research, development, manufacturing, and the negotiation of fair pricing for a wide range of COVID-19 vaccine candidates to ensure participating countries, regardless of income levels, have equal access to COVID-19 vaccines, for which it has committed to secure 2 billion doses by end of 2021. As of now, 186 countries, 85% of the world's population, has joined the facility. My country, Timor-Leste, is one of the 92 advanced market commitment countries assured of receiving the first 20% vaccines at no cost for priority target groups. In addition, vaccines for 80% population have been procured through COVAX, as it may prove more cost-effective. In a show of leadership and solidarity with its neighbors, the Prime Minister of Australia, the Honorable Scott Morrison, pledged $500 million to ensure that vaccines and other COVID-related medical needs are made accessible to all Australia's neighbors. Nobel Peace Prize laureate Professor Muhammad Yunus' global campaign, to which we all adhere, I adhere, for declaring COVID-19 vaccine as a global common good, was signed by 25 Nobel laureates, 41 former heads of state and government, and 87 world-leading business leaders, activists, artists, and academics, including the general population from at least 136 countries. 1 year since the onset of COVID-19 pandemic, the overall situation throughout most of the world has deteriorated. Hospitals and hospital staff are overwhelmed. The virus spread and made a comeback with vengeance where it was initially subjugated, and the prematurely victory was declared. In the US alone, more than 400,000 people died and counting. Worldwide, the numbers are numbing: over 100 million infected, 2 million deaths, over 40 million recovered, but many live with COVID-related effects, from mild to severe. Economies are in tatters, with a staggering social toll, millions thrown back into poverty. Tellingly, meetings of the mighty of the world, the G7, G20, UN Security Council, celebrations of the 75th anniversary of the founding of the UN, are held in virtual bunkers, a humbling acknowledgement of the failure of global leadership and the inequalities of regional and multilateral institutions. But we should take our mind away from COVID-19 and think of fellow human beings in other realities. The daily misery and agony of the millions dying each year of malaria, dengue, tuberculosis, HIV, waterborne illnesses, and more. For them, the tools, the focus on the COVID pandemic has meant less share of the state budget and less share of international aid. For these children of God, there was never serious investment in research towards a malaria and dengue vaccine. After all, this is a problem of the tropics, particularly those hundreds of millions barely surviving in the poor barrios, isolated towns and villages away from the comfort of Western citadels. Speaking on the 75th anniversary of the founding of the UN, Secretary General Antonio Guterres wanted us to feel good about the state of the world, because according to him, major powers have not engaged in full-scale war since 1945. In reality, major powers use proxies to do the killing and then pretend they are immaculately innocent. The decades of 1945 to 2020 are littered with wars of aggression, civil wars, massacres and genocide. The Korean War, the Vietnam War, the Sideshow War in Cambodia, upon which more bombs were dropped by US forces than the tonnage of bombs dropped on European cities during the entire World War II. Fast forward to our times. The wars in the Middle East, Syria, Libya, Yemen are continuing, but no longer making headlines, if they ever occupied much of our daily diet of news. These tragedies have something in common. They are fueled by weapons exports from the US, Russia, France, UK, and China. The privileged five of the world's obsolete collective security that has failed miserably in preventing or ending minor and major conflicts, failing in upholding even their moral duty, protection of civilians. Our world is adrift, leaderless. Global challenges are not met with adequate preventive soft power strategies and action. Hard power tools available to the mighty rich of the world are not lawfully applied, because the powers that could make a difference between war and peace are too busy squandering resources in narrow, selfish rivalries, each bent on regional influence and supremacy. And by playing this century-old gamble, they drag countries and peoples into endless wars. According to Nobel laureate of India, Kailash Satyarthi, every year in the last two decades, the annual wealth of the world has increased $30 trillion. And yet, hundreds of millions of our fellow human beings in the global south do not have access to clean water. This natural treasure that is fast becoming a scarcity in cities and countries across the world. Time to time, Al Jazeera or the BBC inconvenience the middle class and upper class in northern and southern hemispheres, wake them from their moral hibernation with heart-wrenching stories of child labor and child slavery in South Asia, Africa, and Latin America, of scenes of emaciated mothers and their dying babies somewhere in Congo or Yemen. Shockingly, there is never enough budget or aid money for clean water and sanitation, for sustainable agriculture, food security, and child and mother's nutrition. There is never enough money for universal health care and fully equipped hospitals in most of the global south. But there is always money for fleets of presidential jets to fly VIP coquetries for shopping sprees in Europe. Those who claim entitlement to a place of honor in the UN Security Council, G7 and G20 have not shown the required wisdom and leadership to forge regional and global partnerships for action to resolve the many man-made catastrophes plaguing entire communities and nations across the globe. Ladies and gentlemen, nuclear and conventional arsenals are intact. Aspiring nuclear weapons club members are lining up. Leaders of the mightiest armies and wealthiest economies whose nuclear arsenals are capable of blowing up planet Earth several times over are humiliated by a virus that has managed to lodge in the highly protected bunkers of the rich and the powerful. A non-complex enemy is exposing global leadership, failure, and inadequacies of our multilateral and regional institutional constructions. Leaders of nuclear and non-nuclear powers waste trillions of dollars in ever more sophisticated weapon systems, were caught unprepared and unable to respond collectively against this global public health challenge. On a positive note, the frightening speed of the spread of COVID-19 has been matched by an equally extraordinary speed in the development of vaccines by scientists and pharmaceutical companies across the world. Let's pay genuine tribute to the unsung heroes, scientists, doctors, nurses, lab equipment technicians, ambulance drivers, and hospital sanitation personnel. But sadly, as vaccines are churned out in US and Europe, the first recipients of these benefits of science are obviously the peoples of the richer world, in particular North Americans and Europeans. Likewise, trillions of dollars in economic and social rescue packages adopted by the US Congress, the European Union, Japan, were meant for their citizens, while the billions of people living in the periphery see their miserable life and meager survival incomes evaporated as governments impose lockdowns and as industrial output, international trade and investments are reduced to bare minimum or stop altogether in some countries. Even in the face of tens of millions of fellow human beings being thrown back into the agony of poverty, most creditor countries and banks refuse to write off the debt of the now critically impoverished countries. You might be shocked that in my own country, interest charged by the foreign banks operating here in Timor-Leste averages 14% per annum. 14%. And they haven't had the decency to freeze interest payments through this pandemic and the global recession. Those who sign the call for vaccines as a common good, to be made free for all, as with appeals on foreign aid and debt write off, believed that this pandemic and its economic and social cost should unite all, rich and the poor, north and south. We are disappointed. We had a chance, we still have a chance, to wake up, to stand up, to unite rich and poor, north and south, as a human family around the higher purpose of solidarity of humanity. We share the same planet, but we live in different global villages. Most survive in slums. Few live in Alice in Wonderland palatial homes. But we all are vulnerable to this and many other insidious virus and bacteria that may still come. Eventually, among the wretched legions in the periphery, a medically calculated percentage will be inoculated. but those in the rich north and the ostentatiously rich in the poor south certainly realize that if the poor billions of this shared planet are not humanized, eventually the ills afflicting them will transition into and wreck comfort zones of the rich. And if the global south is not supported in meaningful ways to recover their livelihoods, no walls will be thick and high enough to prevent millions of destitute and desperate from flocking to the privileged north. And the last but not least, world's financial institutions, creditors, nations, commercial banks must all write off the debt of all least developed countries and fragile states and the so-called highly indebted countries. Relief from the debt burden, all the countries concerned should double their budget allocations for education, health, child nutrition, food security, employment creation, fostering of small businesses and agriculture, invest in green energy and the blue economy. Weapons exports to all developing countries must be stopped for the next 10 years at least. During this time, regional and multilateral bodies should work towards a comprehensive ban on exports of heavy offensive weapons to regions and countries in conflict. Worldwide mandatory end of torture and a 10-year moratorium on the death penalty. During this time, regional and multilateral organizations should work towards the global prohibition of the death penalty. We should move further on Paris Agreement, set more ambitious targets on CO2 emissions, temperature warming, consistent with the latest alarming reports from the scientific community. We cannot expect that governments alone shoulder this responsibility to mobilize resources to finance the cost of a people-centered global economic recovery. If we really feel as a human family, I issue a challenge to my wealthier fellow family members around the world to nourish and strengthen the health of the entire family, and in doing so, to lift the survival potential of all, including you, your loved ones, with a modern day Marshall Plan. This requires a global vision and the combined support of all, the G7, G20, and the concurrence of the following 10,000 biggest banks in the world, 10,000 biggest companies, 10,000 richest men and women, 10,000 richest foundations, 10,000 richest universities, 10,000 richest churches, to invest in sustainable agriculture, clean energy, clean water, education and health, as well as providing resources to build modern clinics and hospitals, science and the medical research institutes, create meaningful jobs in every country in the world. Some among you might say, I am naive, that what I'm proposing is undoable. To those who are doubtful, are skeptical, I will say, I understand. But to some others, I will say, please spare me your platitudes of realism and pragmatism. They brought us this mess. The luxury of reflection on our connectedness is only of value if it is followed by a plan of action to leave the state of our connected world in tangible ways. Anything less will continue to leave us blindsided, while the economies of the West are buoyed by weapon sales and the death of innocent women and children on the other side of this wall we share. God bless you all. I thank you.
That was an inspiring talk by José Ramos-Horta, and we thank him for his wise contribution. His talk really triggers some urgent questions and thoughts about the current state of the world. Now I invite you to take a short break before we restart the summit at 6 o'clock. See you in a bit.